A very good afternoon to everybody. Namaskar Kolkata. This is Deboshri Banerjee, and it's a thing of great honor and privilege for me to be sitting here among two of our very promising contemporary authors, Preeti Shenoy and Ravinder Singh. So let's have another round of applause for them. I distinctly remember having participated in Write India Season 1. And coincidentally, it was the last day for Preeti's prompt. I got to know about Write India Season 1 from one of my colleagues, and I just checked over the internet, and I saw that it was the closing day. So I was just telling Preeti that my heart was like going boom, 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 that whether I'll be able to submit by midnight or not. But anyway, I wrote for both of them, but I woefully didn't get any position for either of them, though I secured a position for Durjoy Datta and for some others too. So, without going into much more preamble, let's begin. The first question that I want to put to Preeti is, obviously I'll come to Ravinder with that question as well, but first it will be Preeti. So, when and how and under what circumstances, Preeti, did you first realize that you wanted to be a writer?
So, I have always written. Ever since I was a child, I have written. My first book was at the age of 8 or 9, and it was 6 pages long. And 4 pages were writing, 2 pages were illustrations. And it was a cross between the kind of books I was reading at that time, which is between, you know, something between like a Treasure Island, my own version of orphans getting shipwrecked and things like that. So I have always written. And in college, I used to win prizes in creative writing and all that. But I never thought that I would make it successful as an author. I never thought I would become a published author. So that happened quite by chance, because I lost my father all of a sudden in 2006. And it's to get over the grief of losing him that I went public with my writing. Because my writing was dormant. Though I used to write mainly for myself. And from then on, one of my posts on my blog got picked up by a radio show host in the US. It won the Perfect Post Award. Then I went on, some of my poetry was published. And then I started writing for Times of India. I started writing for some local newspapers. The natural progression of all of this, then I wrote for Chicken Soup for the Soul, and the natural progression of all of this was into a book. So, to answer the question in a short way, yeah, I have always written, so.
Thank you, Preeti. We know a bit about Ravinder, actually, under what circumstances he came up with his first book, but if you can touch up with that, Ravinder, a bit.
I'm bored to to make the same statement. I'm making it for 11 years now. So let me give a different statement this time. Before I wrote, I too had a love story I wrote of my personal tragedy. I lost my then girlfriend in a car accident. But my very first piece of work that I wrote was again on an emotional note. I'm an author by chance. I had not read a single novel before I started writing one. And I realized that every time I had this urge to write, whenever I am emotional. So the first time I wrote something was when I was getting transferred, when I was being transferred from Infosys Bhubaneswar to Infosys Chandigarh. I belong to a Punjabi family, born in Kolkata, brought up in Odisha, 25 years. I love fuchka over golgappe because that's how my taste buds have been. So when this transfer was happening at the age of 26, I started crying. That I don't want to go to, that transfer was initiated by me, that I want to go to Chandigarh, because at 26, the Punjabi blood in me wanted to reconnect with his roots that I have missed upon going to Punjab. And I was being given a chance to go to US or Europe. I had H-1Bs, I used to work in Belgium and New York. So the company told me that Chandigarh bahut mushkil hoga, H-1B leke US chale jao. I was working for a US client, and it's easy. But the way the Indian geography right now is with IT, the only corporate office which is in the North India is Infosys, and I badly wanted it. So there were like 30,000 people wanting that job. So I was fortunate enough to get that thing. But the day it got to me, and the very final week I had to leave, I started getting this, goosebumps that, oh my God, I'm going to leave this place, this very place where I have spent so 25 years of my life. So I thought it. I thought to sum up my journey at Infosys in those 5 days. So I would go to office in the morning and I would write day one, how I happened to get in Infy at that point of time. Day two, what my initial project was. Day three was my abroad trip. And the final day was 4 years later, where I was right now collecting all my awards that were placed. And it all had, I had won Mr. Infosys, Snooker, Bhangra, and I did n number of things out there, apart from working on the project. I have done everything, and I was collecting. So I was very emotional. So that was my first piece of writing. And the day I realized that people love what I write is when on the fourth day, I didn't make to my office on time because I got my bike had a flat tire. And I was delayed. So 2 ghante baad mein aaya. And by the time I was in office at 12:30, I opened the email box. There is a general folder in Microsoft inbox wherein entire office can read. So there were at least, I remember 15 emails that Ravinder, where is today's post? So for the first time it sink in, okay, so people are actually waiting for me to post. So that's how I realized I can write. Which is why I took an even bigger step when I wrote I Too Had a Love Story a couple of months after that.
Thank you, Ravinder. The thing that I actually wanted to get out of you was that I remember distinctly that I also used to be a writer, albeit sporadically. I used to write quite sporadically. I didn't write continuously. But in 2014, I had a severe depression anxiety problem. So at that time, I realized that I had to have something to fall back upon in case everything went awry. So I thought that the notebook, the pen and paper, they don't answer back. Everything is going to go there. It's a great sink, you know, to dump all your worries, to dump all your emotions into that. So writing is the most honest thing that can be done in our day-to-day life. So I just wanted to hear that from Ravinder, that actually somewhere I read that Netaji once told that there's a fire burning inside me, and in case I don't get to do something for this country, that fire is going to consume me alive, unless and until I burn the world with my passion. So that is what I think all writers start writing for. They have got this passion to get their words out. Writing is the most honest form of expression as such. So Preeti, what is your all-time favorite book? A book that you can fall back on?
I have so many books which I can fall back on, but I'm a person who reads a lot. So if you follow my Instagram, you will see all the books that I've read this year. I'm on my 53rd book this year. So I wouldn't name one book because there are so many other books out there. Like, it's like too many books, too little time. You know, why would I go back to one book when I can read something new? So when it comes to books, I'm like this excited child waiting to open Christmas presents. Because for me, each book is like, oh wow, this another book, yet another book I have to read. So I read a lot. So I wouldn't name one book because it would be, you know, it would be so unfair to all the other authors who've written so brilliantly. So there's just not one book. There are so many books. And I think the best book is yet to be read. I'm a hopeful reader, you know. Because I read this book and I say, oh my God, this is great. What else can I read which is like this? So then I go and find another author and I keep discovering new authors. So I think that's a great thing because there's so many thoughts and there's so much to be read. Yeah. So there's no one single book that I fall back on. There are like hundreds of books.
Okay, thank you, Preeti. Ravinder, can you name a few of your contemporary authors and the reason why they are your favorites?
My favorite authors, the mic is working. It starts with Preeti Shenoy.
I was hoping you would say that.
Yeah. No, I wanted to start it with you.
You better say that.
I admire Durjoy's writing. I mean, this is contemporary world that I'm talking about. I admire Durjoy's writing. Nicholas Park is somebody who I look forward to read. John Green's only one book that I loved, which entire world loved, was The Fault in Our Stars. That book I really loved. It is one of the books, jispe jo movie bani, wo bhi mujhe pasand aayi. Very rarely I like movies based on novels. Notebook is another one which I love. And these are all romance genres out there. But I do read nonfiction, but your question is on contemporary, so I'm telling you the contemporary one.
Okay. So, Preeti, Because you are a mom, you have got so much to manage. I'd obviously ask you, when you are working on a book, what is your usual schedule like?
So usually, I mean, I always fight with the moderator who asks me this question, because you know they don't ask male authors the same question. Now Ravindra doesn't have kids,
yeah, of course,
but suppose
I know the challenges
suppose there was another male author who had kids. The first thing is I would pounce on the moderator and say, you ask him that question. But I can't obviously do that. But yeah, it's like it's like every other working woman, like or any other working person. I think as a society, we need to stop this narrative that women have to do everything. So I attend a Zumba class in my society. On Saturdays, the class is from 8 to 9. Okay, a lot of women don't come for that class. Why? I have to supervise the maid. Can't your husband supervise the maid? No, he doesn't know. I get like mad when I hear that. So this, it's the same when it comes to writing. You manage your writing like how you manage other areas of your life. So when my kids were younger, okay, I would usually, like my husband would pitch in, and I need solitude to write. So for me, how do I manage to carve that solitude? I would write when they weren't around, because that's when I get my solitude. So now my daughter is right there sitting in the front, and both of them are in college. So I get all the time in the world. I only have my, you know, the littlest four-legged baby who will listen to me, because no one else listens to me in my house. So my four-legged baby listens to me. So I use her as an armrest, and I have all the time in the world, honestly, because I am by myself, like, you know, so I have all the time in the world to write. Yeah, but when they were little, I would manage like any other working person managed their
I mean,
home.
Did you have any deadline set for yourself that I'm going to complete by this time?
I'm a very disciplined writer. So when I start writing, I will not rest till I complete the book, because the book consumes me. So how much ever time it takes, like sometimes, because the book, I mean, it depends. Every day I will write. You know, I will switch off my phone, I'll switch off my social media, I'll disappear. And I will write and write and write till I'm very, very disciplined that way. Publishers would love to hear this.
So. That's a great thing. Really, really. I also love to hear this. Ravindra.
I think to sum up her answer, how do you manage to find time in spite of being a mother? And that she found an understanding man.
Yeah. That's true.
That's very chauvinistic. Because you mean to say that women who don't find understanding men can't write?
It starts.
See, I mean, that's again the burden, the society. Your man has to be understanding, then you can write. No, I don't agree with that at all. I'm going to pounce on you.
Men, please do that. Yeah. I don't care end of the day. Men should learn. I was giving an example that if your husband is out there who is understanding, who can manage a maid, for example, that's what. This country needs to change.
No, but look at this. We are giving credit to a man for managing a maid. I mean, what is this? Like, you know, why should a man get a credit for managing a maid? Is he a helpless person that he can't manage a maid? He's an adult. Yeah, he's a full-grown man. So do men deserve credit for making a cup of tea? You know, some people say.
In a country, in a patriarchal country, I would rather tell a bunch of men, look at that man, if he can do this. And in that narrative, I will give the credit to him. Why can't you do it? That's where I'm
As an
from.
Example, yes. But not that, you know, like I hear this all the time. See, my husband cooks, okay? Oh, you're so lucky your husband cooks. Why should it be that you're lucky your husband cooks? It shouldn't be, that should be the norm. But I agree, we live in a patriarchal society. But we should not normalize. We should not normalize. Some women say very proudly, my husband can't make a cup of tea. And mind you, we are in a country where 73% of the women do not earn. Okay, they choose not to work. We have the lowest labor ratio in the world. I think the countries who are below us are all the countries which have, like, you know, war and things like that. So when this happens, obviously the economic power shifts. The person, let's be very clear, in a marriage, the person who earns is the person who has the higher power. That is the truth. That is the truth. So, you know, because economically, you have two kids. You have two small kids. I've written about this in my book, Tea for Two and a Piece of Cake. She falls for this fantastic, rich guy, and she cannot believe her luck. She's overweight, and this guy falls for her. And later, I mean, she learns to be independent when he leaves her. So, you know, there is this narrative. I feel equality can come only when women earn.
No, it is. It's about the perspective. I will deduce, I will subtract minus one from men who are not standing up to own that task and don't understand gender equality. But I will give that plus one to somebody who understands, which is where I'm coming. I will give credit to that very person out there. Yeah. If your husband is standing here, I will give credit to him. And you cannot say, why are you giving credit to him? I think we are on the same page. I'm talking about a different perspective altogether.
I think basically then, you know, then I would say that, you know, guys in Ravinder's book make tea, but guys in my books make a whole meal. I think, you know, we had an exchange on that once, Ravinder. Like, you know, the guy makes tea for the woman, but in one of my books, like, the guy cooks a whole meal. I think that's the place that we are coming from.
Yeah.
But yeah.
So, Ravinder, the next question for you is, if you were not writing romance, what would be the genre that you would be writing for?
Then I would be writing social issues. Okay. And in non-fiction, not in fiction.
Okay.
Romance happened to click. And time after writing certain social issues, I will take a break and would say, I now only want to write an entertainer.
Great.
I will go by that.
Thank you. Preeti, you were saying that you are engaged in a lot of activities other than reading and writing. So as a writer, I would like to know that, do you think that these activities, they actually ventilate you? Like, they help you perform better as a writer? Because sometimes as writers, we all know that we have our own hurdles when nothing comes to us. We are just blank. Whatever you call it is writer's block or whatever. But what do we do during those periods? Does indulging in those other activities really help us out?
Yeah, see, I am a person with diverse interests. I paint, I do yoga, I grow my own vegetables. I'm a fitness enthusiast, I do Zumba, I travel a lot. Yeah, so I would say that these activities do help me. Because, you know, what happens is, indirectly, they find a way into my writing. So there will be some character who's growing vegetables. There will be some character who is a fitness instructor. So coming to the writer's block, personally, I feel it's a myth. Because I always have this advice to give to people who say they have a writer's block. So writer's block comes in when you believe that whatever you write has to be outstanding. It has to be great. It has to be fantastic. And then you get nervous. What if I'm not able to write that? So then you are blocked, you're not able to write. So I always give, I teach creative writing, my courses are on Udemy and Skillshare. So I always give a simple thing. I say that pretend that you are in front of a blind person, okay? So the person can't see what you're seeing. So start writing, you know, describe this beautiful chandelier, describe this red stage, describe the circular tables with the white tablecloth and the black bottom. When you have written a paragraph, you have solved your writer's block. It's simple. So my advice is, you know, do not put pressure on yourself that, because everything you write won't be great, but you can still write. You can write a blog post, you can write an email, you can write a paragraph, you can write in a journal, you can write something and, you know, burn it. It can be therapeutic. But, you know, don't give yourself that pleasure. Do other things. And I think it's very important for writers to travel to other places, because that kind of opens up those in your mind. You meet different people. You don't know what can, you know, set off that little spark which can later grow into a book. Maybe it will grow into a short story. Maybe it will grow into a book. But unless you give that little seed or that little spark, and how do you give those little seeds or spark? By traveling, by reading, by talking to other people, by keeping your ears, eyes, everything open. You know, once the more open you are, the more things come to you. That's what I believe.
Yeah, I understand, Preeti. Continuing from here, actually, it's on the same topic. Ravinder, after you wrote your first book, because I believe that it was under very, you know, pressing circumstances and emotional things were going on. So after you had completed your first book, did you feel drained? Did you feel that nothing more was coming out of you at that time?
No, I didn't want to write the second one, actually. I didn't write to become an author. I didn't write because I want that the book would be a bestseller. I had a very different purpose to write, and instead of feeling drained, I felt very light at my heart. You know, I just lightened up because it was catharsis to vent out the entire steam in my system. I felt lighter. But what happened is eventually the book became a bestseller, and forget about even becoming bestseller, even if there are 100 people who would come to me and tell me that, oh my God, it just moved me so much. And I would say, I'm so touched, I'm so glad that A, you chose to read a debut author, B, perhaps you bought the book, you would have, some money would be credited to my royalty, and I'm so delighted that you spent some of your valuable time reading a first-time author's work. So I'm indebted to you. But then they would go back with, they would have asked this question, sir, agla kitab kab aa raha hai? And I was like, oh my God. So this is when I failed, oh my God, this is, I'm like drained. What do I write now?
Yeah.
I don't even have a content to write. I never planned to write something. So I thought maybe there are just 100 people who want to read my next, and they're just not serious. They're in that moment of finishing my book, so they're emotional. But this never ended. 1 year, 2 year, 3 year. After 3.5 years, I happened to bring my second novel out because I was literally egged at events that you cannot do this to us. You cannot not tell us what happened to this character called Ravan in the first novel. You have to tell what happened with him because we are, you know, stuck in a limbo.
Yeah.
We want to see what happened.
Yeah.
And I felt that this pressure was too much for me because I started getting emails on the email ID that I had mentioned in my author bio in the very first book. I remember clearly those were the Orkut days. On Orkut, there was a page made, and somehow this all, I was on a scrapbook. I think that was a jargon, scrapbook. So they were like, people were making groups and bombarding messages. You cannot. So I thought, this is something crazy happening. Maybe there is something I should understand, that there is some power in my writing, and I have unleashed a Pandora's box now. So I must go and cater to that. So I happened to write my second one. I wrote my first one at Infosys. The second one I wrote at ISB when I was doing my MBA. And then it worked extremely well. So this time the change was, every publishing house who had rejected my first novel was on board and wanting its sequel.
Yeah.
So it was my wow moment. And I now wanted to cherish my wow moment. So here comes a publisher who would say, we are going to offer you an advance also. I was like, crazy, are you offering me an advance? Like, this never happened to me. So I started enjoying that, and I thought, okay, let me write something. And the pre-orders, I remember, the book was about to get in print, and suddenly the pre-orders spiked up. So the publishers gave me a call and told me that we were doing certain 1,000 copies, but now the figure has crossed 1 lakh. I was like, are you sure? I mean, have you not read the zeros incorrectly? Because kitab aane se pehle, bestseller banne se pehle, how are you going to give an order of 100,000 plus copies? They said, no, we have got orders for it. I was like, okay, so I should think seriously about this career now because it's exploding. So I wrote, I always say this, your second work in any creative era that you are in, or any creative platform you are on, either movies or songs or writing or whatever it is, the second work is the true litmus test. It is going to tell you whether or not you own your skills so much that there is an audience who crave for your work. And it worked really well. And that's when I started writing, okay, every year and a half, I have to come out with my next novel. So then I started getting this slight pressure, okay, now there is an expectation created. The pressure was not to deliver the book, the pressure was to, how do I meet the expectation of my reader? Because when I'm writing my first novel, I have zero expectation. I don't even know who my audience is going to be. So you feel free. But now there is an expectation, sir, because there will be comparison. Sir, ye wali love story mein na wo baat nahi thi jo pehle wali mein thi. So, but mere liye to thi na, which is why I wrote it. So you have to maintain a balance of it and get going with your impulse out there. Because unless you try, otherwise people also, you know, say, aapne kuch naya nahi likha. When you write something, so in a creative world, you are so vulnerable and there are different voices. You cannot appease everyone. Get an idea what people are looking forward to and maintain a balance of what you want to say. Ultimately, it should always be about what you want to say, but in what format are they going to absorb it is a question.
So Ravindra, did you did you identify the probable group of readers for your second book? Because it was a lot of pressure, as you were saying. I was thinking, how did you handle that amount of pressure? Because obviously people had expectations pinned on you since your first novel, it was a bestseller. So how did you channelize that pressure into something positive so that your second novel was another smashing hit?
The only way to handle the pressure was to be honest with the story. The first story was an honest anecdote of the events that happened. The second story, I knew there is a good amount of honesty in it, and I knew that there's a good amount of fiction that I have to create in it. It has to be a right balance of it. But whatever I am writing, I am not writing because I want to tell the world, look, I am a hero, in that, because that book is autobiographical in nature. It's first person language. I would leverage the book to talk about what even I did wrong and the kind of confessions that I want to make to the whole world because I did wrong to this particular girl in that particular context. So the moment you are writing an honest book, and if it's about you as a character, we all are shades of gray. And the moment you serve people just the way we are, there's a lot more acceptance to it. I think that is the way it worked out for me.
That is letting the world know who you really are, or at least part of it.
True.
Yeah.
Because we all have our own hidden secrets, which we feel that, oh my God, if others get to know about me, how are they going to judge me? But we tend to forget that even those others have their own secrets, and perhaps their secrets will resonate with you, and they are going to love you because you gave them the guts to come out and tell the world, even I am like this.
Exactly. You know? So you set an example for them. Thank you. Preeti, what is one piece of advice that you would like to give to wannabe authors? The most important thing, you can share your own experiences too, but the most important thing according to you.
So I was just listening to Ravinder and I was just nodding because it was so eerily similar to the experience that I had. And we both started our careers with the same publisher. Both of us were published, both of us were published by the same publisher, and like him, it was, it was exactly as though he was telling what I experienced. I was just, nodding very intently, listening to him. And the one piece of advice which I would like to give aspiring writers is read as much as you can. Extremely important to read a varied variety of books. Two is write every single day. If you want to have a great physique, you go to the gym and you lift weights so that your muscles get developed. I mean, how will your writing muscles and your thinking muscles get developed unless you practice it? So, write every day, whatever you want to write, write. Write a blog post, write an email, write in your journal, write poetry, but write. I think I can see the improvement in my own writing. Do creative writing courses simply because they teach you the craft. There are so many courses out there. There are so many free courses out there. If you go to my website, there is an FAQ section where I have linked these courses. I think I've answered a question, how to get published in India, because a lot of people don't know how to get published. So please go to my website, preetishenoy.com, and I have answered this question, how to get published in India. Click on that link. I have linked courses which are free. So please do those courses on character development, on writing the plot, on creating a plausible story, and read books on the craft of writing. Stephen King's book on writing is by far one of the best books I have read on the craft of writing. So that is my one advice to wannabe authors and wannabe writers. And the other thing is, do not bother about what others are going to think about you. Because if you are going to think about, if I write this, my aunt might think this, or my mother might think this. So the honesty element has to come. You have to have a thick skin. Because I always say this, writing is like standing naked in front of a room full of people and inviting them to make comments, because you are sharing a very vulnerable part of yourself. Only the writer will know how much of truth is there, how much of fiction is there, but you are going to be vulnerable. There are going to be people who are going to criticize you, who are going to tear you down. You have to be stronger than that to write. So these points are what I would like to tell aspiring authors and writers. And do not give up. Do not ever give up. My second book was rejected. Second book, mind you. My first book was published. Second book was rejected over 40 times. That book has sold more than 1 million copies now. It's been translated to several languages. So do not ever give up. Because if you give up, that's it. You know, that's the end of the road for you.
Another question, Preeti. For your first venture, how did you think of, you know, coming up with creative nonfiction actually?
Because, you know, I did not know what to write. I knew I wanted to be an author. And what was the truest thing I was going through at that time? I had this collection of stories which mostly involved my kids, their little things. I have written about a tooth fairy, you know, and I have written about deeply moving stories which everybody would have experienced. So I found that easy to tell those stories, because that's coming from a place of absolute truth. And I could also use my skills, okay, my skills which I have done creative writing courses. So I could use those skills to tell those stories in an interesting way. So that's how and basically my blog got a lot of readers. So they're all adapted from my blog posts. So I never expected that. So because I started getting emails from people around the world, where is your next blog post coming? I would get comments. They said, why don't you put all this into a book? So I said, okay, that's a great idea. I want to become an author. I already have a blog. Why don't I put this in a book format? So that's how I wrote about creative nonfiction, probably the first at that time. And that was my first book.
Thank you, Preeti. Ravinder, according to you, it takes a lot of things to be a good writer. But what does it exactly take to be a commercially successful author?
Two things. Engineering and MBA. keep it simple, I think. And write something that people can relate to. You have to understand your audience very well if you are talking about making it to a successful commercial author, because you introduce this word commercial out there. And if you have to make a good living, you have to sell good number of volume, then it is also a venture in itself. Then you are simply not an author. Your work as an author is finished the moment you have finished writing that manuscript. The moment it is done, what I do is I don a very different hat altogether. The moment it is done, I am now a marketing person. The moment the book comes out to shops and Amazons and Flipkarts of the world, I would don a salesperson's hat. And I would want to tap the numbers, get an insights, what kind of promotion stuff we should do, which cities we should pick up. I will go and do a lot of data analysis on my social media. What is my TG? At what point of day are they consuming my post? What kind of posts are getting what kind of responses? It's a whole lot of marketing that you have to give it to. And I am able to do it because I'm interested in doing so. I know a bunch of people who would have completely outsourced this to people who have the sensibility to get this done also, which is also perfectly fine. But I would put myself out there on social media and connect with my readers, because unlike other forms and unlike other celebrities from different walks of life who are available on television, authors are the bunch of, you know, public figures who are missing on the television. And right now, anyway, television doesn't exist anymore. But I would leverage the power of internet to hold on to them. At one point of time, when 10 years back, when I had come out with the first novel, the newspapers refused to review my works because I am a contemporary mass market author, not somebody who would write a literary fiction or write something political, for which there was more acceptance. And 5 years down the line, when they happened to see, oh my God, and I'm just not speaking for my own self, a bunch of other commercially successful authors, when these media houses took notice of the kind of fan following these authors had, then the heads turn, and then they tend to believe that maybe they are doing something incredible which we are not aware of. Let's interview them. Let's talk about their books. So yeah, things change, but you have to give a lot of it for that to happen.
Thank you, Ravindu. Preeti, what according to you is the most unethical practice in the publishing industry right now?
To add to what Ravinder said, the moment we finish our books, I think we become traveling salesmen. Yeah. And you know, you have to sell your books basically. So you will see posts, swipe up, buy my book. You will see a lot of posts. And yeah, if you are interested in, you know, books doing big numbers, I think you have to do. You have to, if you have written a book, you have to have the courage to stand up and say, hey, this is my book. I have written it. Buy my book. Because unless you do it, no one else is going to do it for you. And to come back to your question, which is the most unethical practice. Now, I hate this practice personally of buying followers and buying reviews. All my followers are 100% organic. I haven't bought a single follower. They are following me because they are interested in my content. Same for reviews. So I was shocked the other day when I got an email where this has become a business. So there are a bunch of people, you know, who have made this a business. They write to authors and say, we will give you honest reviews. Now, honest in inverted commas, okay? Because you're paying them to review your book. Now, for me, I read a lot of books. I review a lot of books. I don't charge anybody anything. Because when I read a book, I want, when I'm excited about the book, I want others to read about the book. So I go and tell others about it. So for me, I found the practice very shocking that people are actually paying for reviews. People are actually buying followers. I find that abhorrent. I would never do it. So because I feel it defeats the purpose of, you know, because see, the book, you can do as much marketing as you want. But the book will have repeated, it might, if you buy reviews, it might sell in the short term. You might come on the Nielsen list one time or two times. But look at it over a period of 7 years, 8 years. Okay, now the only thing that will sell a book is word of mouth. For example, my book, Life is What You Make It, every Saturday, check out HT Nielsen list, it will be there. The sequel to that, Wake Up Life is Calling, mostly it's there. That's only word of mouth. Okay, that's only word of mouth. So I do believe that buying reviews, buying followers, don't do it. You know, even if you're tempted to buy, don't do it. Just be patient. If the book is good, it will come. Do your marketing, tell people, and, you know, I find that abhorrent.
Thank you, Preeti. Actually, it is the same with Instagram and Facebook also, I think. They are buying followers over there. People are. So,
see, I would rather, like, if you want, I mean, don't spend money on buying followers. You might as well put an ad because your thing reaches many more people.
Yeah.
Okay, spend on, I mean, if you have to spend, spend on advertising so people see that there is a product out there. You know, talking about commercial fiction, your book is a product at the end of the day. If it has to sell, someone has to know that your books exist. Now, in bookstores, when you go, it's only the successful authors who are displayed. Okay, you will see piles of books of certain other authors. What will a new author do? Because your book will be somewhere in the back. Nobody will even know.
Yeah, I understand.
So how do you do that? You and okay, the other tip that I have, say suppose you have written a book on say travel. Okay, what you could probably do is contribute to travel portals who are looking for articles, and then put a link back to your book. So something like that you can do, where you give useful content to people. Okay, give away useful content to people. And one more thing, do not ever become active only when you have a book to promote. Okay, everyone is going to see through that. If you are active, like, be active throughout. Like, I blog throughout the year. When nobody was reading me, also I was blogging. Today, thousands of people are reading me. I'm still blogging. So be sincere, be genuine, and that's what people connect to.
Yeah, I do understand. But then there are reclusive people like me. The next question to Ravinder. Ravinder, have you ever pushed yourself outside of your comfort zone while writing?
Yeah, I've done that in different aspects, actually. A, by changing the genre itself, not writing romance. When I know that people expect to read romance out of me, my last novel, The Belated Bachelor Party, there is zero romance in it. Forget about romance, there is no girl in it. It's a story of four men, and that too, they are married men, so there is no scope of romance also happening. So I would challenge myself, knowing that I have done enough of romance, and maybe I should bring something very different. And if it works, I can continue. Even if it doesn't work, or either way, I will go. I have three more romances in pipeline, but after that is done, I will again bring something which is very different. My third novel, Like It Happened Yesterday, is about the entire childhood story of growing up. There's a novel that I wrote called This Love That Feels Right. This is where I challenged myself to an extreme extent. I had to do a lot of research. I had to meet a lot of people, take their thoughts in private, in front of their girlfriends or wives or husbands. This novel is based on, there are two love stories going in parallel, and both love stories have extramarital affair element. Okay. One is adultery, wherein the woman is cheating on her husband. And in the second love story, the woman is dating another guy because she is an open marriage.
Okay.
So it's a very different counter perspective going on. And I wanted to write this because as a romance writer, looking for new content, and also I was, this thought didn't let me sleep that why attractions come to play at the first place. And if they do come to play, why do we look upon them in a bad light if these are very natural, if attractions are as natural as love? Where do you draw the line in adultery? Is it committing that act, or even thinking about it in your head is adultery? You're making out with your husband, but you are imagining George Clooney. Is that adultery? So all those thoughts of, all these thoughts, when I summed up, I thought, okay, this is the subject that I want to write about. And that's where I step out of my comfort zone. So for me and my publishers thought that this is extremely risky, which is true. It was extremely risky. For somebody like me who had built up an image and this persona matter, and when you are doing a commercial work of fiction, a lot rides on your ideology, your thought process, your identity, your persona. That I am seen as somebody who writes about eternal and emotional love. I started writing by writing a tribute to my dead girlfriend. And the question somebody would ask me that, look at this guy, he used to write emotional and eternal love stories, and today he's trying to sell extramarital affair in today's society. So yeah, those are the risks that you take as a creative person. But end of the day, I got to say what I got to say.
Exactly. So, Preeti, you're...
Yeah, before coming to your question, to add to what Ravinder said, I think in India, you have to separate the author from the person. Okay, since a lot of popular books are written in first-person narrative, they presume that it is that person's story. So, I have written about extramarital affairs too in Secret Wishlist. And at that time, I had also written an article, a popular magazine, I think it was Vogue or one of those magazines which approached me. So I had written an article, how to have an extramarital affair and not get caught. Okay, so that was the article. So everyone was like, how can you write about this? But it was a publicity thing which my publicist wanted me to write because the magazine would be read by so many people, and that was my third book. So I did write the article, I did get the mention, and the book did get picked up, and the book did generate a lot of interest. So you have to separate, I feel, the person from the book. And the person's moral, this thing, of course, your personality will creep into the book. But, you know, I think in India, it's extremely essential. It's only in India we get asked these questions that, oh, is this your story? Like, I get asked that all the time. You know, I could really... Then I now take that as a compliment. So I'm like, how can I be... I have written 12 books. How can I be 12 people? How can I be Deeksha? And how can I be Ankita? And how can I be Nidhi? You know, so they find there is definitely some of us in our books, but our books are not us. Yeah, and to come back to your question, sorry, I had to, you know, make this point.
No, it's okay. I believe there are a lot of people who are eager on asking questions, so we would like to touch up about your coming projects, just a bit, your coming books or whatever.
So my next book will be out in April 2020, and it's going to be a very different book. It's going to be a very interesting book, and that's all I can tell at the moment.
Thank you.
You can follow me on social media for all updates.
And what about you, Ravinder?
The second half of the next year is when my next one is due.
Okay.
But I'm doing a lot of audiobooks these days. I also run a publishing venture called Black Ink.
Yeah.
Where I publish debut authors. So there are a lot of projects lined up. I will be publishing them. A lot of international authors have made it to Black Ink, and I'm adding more to that. So that will happen before I will bring out my next one.
I quite like the Black Ink because you're the only, Black Ink is the only one which gives that a little voice to that alternate, because either you have commercial fiction which caters to the young, or you have literary fiction. Then there is this middle ground, okay, about protagonists who are maybe 30-something who have kids. And I'm very happy about that Black Ink.
Thank you so much.
So now we move on to the question answer session. If yeah.
I have a question for both of you that like from the last session I had this question that reading changes reading when we read something we become some, we tend to become it influences us. So when we were all kids there we used to read fairy tales where it majority of the times it's the every girl that's maybe she is a princess she is a queen anything she waits for a man to come who is a stranger altogether stranger and he will approach her and he will be a dream man for her and all and she will never say like she will never do anything for her own gallantry so is that the set that always that this we the whole world not only in India but and abroad also that we the young girls we grow up in this mindset that okay someday some man will come of our imagination and if it is so then what is the way out because that's like for me I don't think that's real like why should we wait for another man if I like someone I can directly go and approach someone but when I will tell this they are like oh okay so girls don't approach don't you know that there
okay,
there is Prince Charming.
I think we got your point you wanted to know that why cannot female female think of themselves as taking up a proactive role
exactly
yeah in salvaging in, what yeah
when at that young age like yeah. when now when I read then I find like there are many women out there who are approaching but that young age when the thing is growing
yeah,
up
I do understand us. I think part of this has already been discussed because we are living in a patriarchal society basically so earlier go back 50 or 100 years back not only in India but around the world the primary earning members were all men isn't it so the fairy tales and everything they were like folklore in nature so they were written in a way so that there were male protagonists who were going to act as rescuers who were going to you know they were damsels in distress they were waiting for someone to come up and rescue them but I guess you asked the question to them so let Preeti
I think there's still a market for that kind of writing but I frankly think those are the wrong kinds of books to read all my women are empowered all my women you know fight their own battles they don't need anyone but they do come from a patriarchal society which is why I think a lot of women connect to my books
exactly
so you know because they have to break these shackles especially in India from an Indian perspective that is the truth but that having said that there is also a market for the Milson Boone kind of romance exactly. where there's this damsel in distress because it does cater to something very primitive in us
yeah.
okay that's coming from a evolutionary perspective that's coming from a biological perspective I mean all women like it when someone does something for them when the guy goes and fights for them
yeah,
or when
chivalry
the guy
chivalry is one thing that we all
chivalry.
You know yeah we
you
all
know,
adore
when,
yeah,
yeah when you're cold and a guy takes his coat and gives it to you and you wear it and you feel all good and that's you're hardwired into your brain so there is a market for that kind of writing too But
so
I think
what do you think that that imagination comes from like because we have grown up
I just answered that you're hardwired so that is why there is a you know that's why there is a market for that kind of thought that kind of writing there is a market for it
I think I would like to add to that you can take your chair we cannot go back in the past and fix the past
yeah.
in case you haven't
absolutely
in today's time I think there is a conscious effort being put in terms of the kind of content that we bring out a lot of authors bring out I certainly do not write for kids but I think there is a conscious effort being put out even parents I know of my friends who have kids and then they told me please do not get a doll for my daughter get her a Ferrari car and perhaps you can get a doll for my boy as well so and do not get something pink for my daughter bring any other color There's a very conscious effort being put, but it's happening only in the metros and cosmopolitans. The need is the voices like you take this entire message down in different parts, just not in Kolkata, but rest of the West Bengal, for example. Then we are going to see the change. But I'll also tell you a different side of the story. For example, in my novel, and again, I'm not trying to sell my novels, the boy is the shy types, and the girl is the confident one. This morning itself I made a Instagram post I don't know if you happen to see that he was 17 she was 16 but he was a shy type and she was a bold one so she kissed him first and the boy said I liked it So end of the day, Rupali, for example, in Will You Still Love Me, the boy never had the confidence, but Rupali happened to hold his hand and say, and tell him that I love you. And he was like, oh my God, this is happening. Your dreams are mine now. So there are novels. So I do not write for kids, but I write for people like you who would find that these women are not waiting for their Prince Charming to come on a white horse and they're just taking the initiative. Men also in today's time would love the idea that, okay, the women, you know, approaches us. Of course, I'm not talking about the different mindset who are going to judge, oh, about the character, that how could she come and be so upfront. But there are good number of men who would feel, who even today lack confidence. They are just waiting, ye kab akeli hogi, tab main jaake usko bolna chahta hun. And all they need, this is also reality, all they need in that moment is a little courage, which perhaps the smile of that girl is going to pass on so that he will have the guts to walk on to her and then tell her. This is again a different side of the story. There's another little thing that I want to add. Lot of time readers and women readers who happen to come to me and tell me that I could not relate to it. Aisa thodi hota hai. In the society that we live in, the boy has to approach. The boy has to pay for the date ka bill. So A, when there are creative people who are trying to change the course, there is a counter expectation also. I would debate, I loved Kabir Singh as a movie, and I was talking about Kabir Singh in the previous session. But I hate the guy in the real life. If I were a girl, I would not date a Kabir Singh. But then when I talk to girl, and there are good number of girls who said, mujhe to Kabir Singh jaisa hi ladka chahiye. So this is the reality, and I'm not going to digress it, but this is the true India that we are living in. So as a content creator, I am appalled ki yaar, how do I judge this thing? Because end of the day, the movie is a great hit, right? And there are voices out there. So as somebody who happens to see all these, it is my job and my responsibility to share all sorts of perspective with my audience, to give you a very generic answer from different voices. Thank you so much.
Yeah, ma'am, please.
The question is, I'm trying to understand, I would like to write something in the non-fiction category, but address to the youth that who are mainly your readers. However, how would you say you connect to them? What are some of the key points which help you connect to them and make you what you do relevant? What are the trends that you see that, you know, makes your audience really feel that what you are saying is their voice?
Well, the risk here is that even before you are coming out with your work, you are trying to segment the audience who is going to read it. That's one big risk. I would not do that. A, I would start up by telling the world what I have to tell. And if it's a conscious effort that, okay, I need a certain demography to read me, then I think instead of asking this question, I have to sit and spend time with this demography. What are the kind of contents that they enjoy? What is the language do they understand? Can you keep them hooked on to what you are writing? Are the kind of questions that you need to ask, because understanding on your face they are going to tell you, yes madam, aap likhiye, main padunga. But that's not the way the world works. You have to ask them the question, what are you watching these days? Why are you watching it? What exactly do you love about it? What are you reading? What exactly do you love? Why do you read Ravindra's novels, for example? And perhaps the answer could be, he doesn't write like Salman Rushdie, for example. And I'm no way demeaning anybody out here, but there's a different kind of language in which Salman Rushdie would write versus what I would write. Maybe they just love to make the point very quick and in a simple way. So you will get to see so many traits once you are spending time with that audience, because this is the very first time you would be writing for them. In my case, I wrote and then I discovered, okay, these are the people who read me, and I kind of connected with them. Thank you.
Preeti, you got anything to add to it?
See, basically when I write for young people, I have, like, say, suppose my protagonist is 18 or 19. My daughter who's sitting right here is my first reader. So I ask her, can you relate to this? Then sometimes she'll tell me, Ma, people my age don't do this. Or people my age will say this. Or, you know, Ma, this is a thing which teenagers use nowadays. So I think it's important to spend time with them, listening to them. What do they have to say? Because obviously, I'm not going to get more authentic than, you know, more authentic than my protagonist who is of the similar age group. So when I am writing for, say, if my protagonist is 25 or 26, I would probably ask my 25, 26-year-old friends, like, you know, will you read this? And again, honesty is very critical. So I have a set of honest readers who will tell me as it is. If something is not working, they'll tell me, look, this is not working. People our age won't think like this. So when my protagonist was an 86-year-old man, I did spend time with a lot of senior citizens and asked, is this what you think? Is this what you believe? And they said, yeah, these are our problems. This is what I think. This is what I believe. So I think it's important to spend time with that. You know, if you're creating a character, or if you're writing about problems of that age group, it's important to spend time with them, listen to them, take their input. And again, honesty is of paramount importance because you can't like choose people who will just say something you want to hear. You have to choose people who are going to be honest with you. So that's where the role of early readers and research, that's where the role of research comes in. That's what I want to add to what Ravinder said. And I agree with him, what he said.
Any other questions?
So my question is to like both of you, that when you have got the first work, say, published, and then there are a lot of problems, like say, like I am a student and I have already got like one story published. So like, how do I move ahead with that one, say the second story? Because say, when you're not that popular, there are inconsistencies with the publishing companies. And see how to like get to the fore and like make some headway into it. That's all.
Well, I don't know. So what exactly is the roadblock here?
The roadblock, as in like, first of all, like how to source like the.
Just the way you source the first one.
No, as in if I don't have say any competition I can participate in or like anywhere like I. Where
was it a book that you wrote, the first one? Was it a book?
No, it was a short story.
It's a short story.
Yeah.
So what do you want to do now?
Like write another one again and like...
A short story?
Yes.
Again?
And then get it to some...
So you will, if it's only a short story of 2,000 words, either you bring out a collection of short stories and then you reach out to a publishing house, but if it is only a short story, then you will have to wait for some publishing house who is doing a crowdsourced anthology. I am doing a crowdsourced anthology early next year sometime. But apart from that, today in the world of Amazon Kindle, there are a lot of people who are writing their e-singles. So if you see yourself as an author who only writes short stories, maybe you need to get onto Amazon and e-singles and start, you know, submitting your short stories out there. And if people find it valuable, they are going to read it and perhaps you will earn money. If there are a good number of readers buying your short story.
All right, thank you.
Yeah, I have a lot of short stories which I have published on Kindle. So, you know, that's a good platform. I write short stories too, in addition to my novels. So that's what I do.
Any other questions from the audience?
My question is from Ravinder, sir. Sir, actually, I wanted to ask you that what was in your mind when you wrote I Too Had a Love Story? I mean, why that topic? Why that story? Why not something else?
Were you there when I answered this question in the beginning?
Sir, I was late actually.
I wrote it because I wanted to step out of this sad place of my life. I wanted a much needed closure. I had lost my then girlfriend. So I just didn't know how to cope with this tragedy. And I would cry myself to sleep for 3 continuous months. And one day I decided this is enough. I need to move on. And the way I thought I could move on was to relive that courtship period one more time by writing it. This was the first time I had fallen in love. So it was too dear to me. And this was a long distance relationship. We were in front of each other's eyes for less than 24 hours. So I thought, let me, you know, relive this in the longest process. I wanted to bring her back in this world in my own way. I think she's alive in the pages of my work. And I believe that, I mean, this is true. people die, but their stories are left back. And I felt my love story is the greatest love story to me. And I wanted to leave it behind. I thought someday I'll have kids and they will have their kids. And maybe they, when they go to their school in 2080, they are going to tell to their friends, you know, mere dada ji ki badi solid love story thi. So I just wrote it that. That's just
so does that mean that all the incidents in the book are for real? That happened for real?
Unfortunately, yes. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Now, it's just one question from me, actually, to both of you. In certain circumstances, we see that a lot of research work is needed to be done before you start writing. So what are your sources, actually? I mean, if it's not very personal, what are your sources that you rely on?
No, it's not personal at all. I mean, research, you talk to people, you interview people, you ask them their experiences, you have the internet, you use every possible resource on the internet, you have books, read up those books, you go to libraries, you gather information from libraries, there are articles, there are scholarly articles, read up, so that's research. Travel to places. So that's research. Make your own notes.
No, I mean some new, you know, writers who are in the process of writing their first or their second books, they might be looking for organizations who do that thing professionally for them. Do you know of any?
Why would a new author spend money to, you know, do research on a book which they don't even know whether will be published? So I would highly recommend, you do your own research first. Yeah, just pick up the phone and talk to people. You're talking about you're writing about an old person, pick up your phone and call your grandfather or your grandmother and ask, you know, aapke zamane mein kya hota tha, like, and make diligent notes on it.
Like,
you don't need any organization to, research that for you and then pay money to the organization, to a book which may never even be published. So,
yeah,
frankly, my answer is very practical. Like.
Yeah, I do understand. Okay, so.
Hello, check. Well, I believe there would be a lot of more other questions, which deal with in the author's book signing area, where we can find both this and even to guest out here and share your questions, your thoughts, and get your book signed. But nevertheless, let's put our hand together and applauding a very learning session, which was Write India, Nurture New Talent, Ravinder Singh, Preeti Shenoy, and Debashree Banerjee. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot, guys.
Thank you so much.